Attention. At this moment, you are now listening to
a Radio 1 show.
This remarkable, sometimes incoherent transcript illustrates a phantasmagoria of fear, terror, grief, exultation, and finally breakdown. Its highlights have been compressed on this recording to make their own disquieting points.
Herring's Fist of Fun.
From Lancaster University.
All right, calm down. There's no need to be sarcastic. I'm Stuart Lee.
And I am known as Richard Herring.
That's right, and welcome, people of Lancaster and all 1FM listeners out there in Radio Land, to the sometimes incoherent Fist of Fun.
Fist of Fun.
And if Fist of Fun was a breakfast cereal, it wouldn't be common sense oat and bran flakes. Oh, no. It would be stupid, unnecessary risk, broken glass and razor blade crispies. With a frosted sugar coating.
Well, not necessarily with a frosted sugar coating, because that's sort of high calorie. You don't want to go mad.
Oh, no.
Fist
of Fun isn't a breakfast cereal. It's a comedy show. I don't know how I could have made the mistake in the first place. What happens is Stuart and I look at the world from a sort of perspective of two immature men who live on limited means in South London and form their opinion of everything in the world, from politics down to the smallest little piece of dirt there is, from the Richard and Judy This Morning show. We've courted controversy as much as we could in the previous episodes, so much so that our postbag has been literally filled with over one letter. Mr. Miles Hadley of Southampton. Hello, Mr. Hadley.
Hello.
He asks, do you not realise that Jesus Christ is a figure worshipped as God by several million people? Well, no, Mr. Hadley, we hadn't realised that. I'm sorry, you know. Sorry.
But it is good to have a rough estimate of the figures there, yeah, for how many it is. So do keep your vague stabs at estimating the size of different religions coming in.
Yeah.
That's good.
Keep your letters coming in on any subject, and we'll then read them out in a sarcastic voice and make you look stupid.
That's right.
Fist of Fun.
Anyway, what have you been up to this week, Rich? What's interested
well,
you?
Well, I've actually moved from my horrible mouse-infested flat in South London,
oh, yeah,
to a horrible slug-infested flat in South London. Mm. It's actually your flat.
That's my flat, isn't it? Yeah.
Just for a little while. There's nothing funny going on. Apart from that, I've been up to the same things as usual, you know, sort of playing on the old Game Boy, drinking large amounts of Diet Coke.
Yeah.
And every morning at 9:30 till 10 a.m, I, of course, have been watching Supermarket Sweep. Yeah. Yeah, it is amazing. There's some fans in the audience. Good to see you up at that time. I can't work out, like, if it's high surrealist art, you know, or just an obviously terrible idea for a game show presented by a man with the personality of a spit-drenched rag.
Yeah, it's the spit-drenched rag one, isn't it?
I think so, yeah. But the terrible thing is, Stu, I actually think it's the most compelling piece of television I've ever seen and have yet to miss an episode. And this is the really sad thing. When I am at the checkout and I hear the beep, I do start trying to think of the fun I might be having on Supermarket Sweep. It's just terrible. Anything caught your attention happened to you, Stu?
Well, I'd like to take this opportunity to say hello to the man in Manchuria Road, Clapham South in London, who I saw watching a hardcore porn video through his open curtains earlier this week. He was rewinding it over all the really good bits as well in, like, slow motion, so what a nice chat.
Yeah.
For 35 years, Blue Peter has provided ideal role models in character and behaviour for Britain's youth. Until earlier this year, when John Leslie blew it out of their arse by chucking the most beautiful girl in Britain today, Catherine Zeta-Jones. What a twat!
And the 35th anniversary of Blue Peter gave us a chance to see again our favourite classic sequence, where John Noakes, struck by a sudden attack of colitis, loses control of his bowels and tries to blame it on a baby elephant.
You know, Stu, recently I've been putting on quite a lot of weight, which I can't understand, because I drink 4 litres of Diet Coke a day. 4 litres. I'll tell you, there's got to be something wrong with my glands or something on there for that to happen.
Yeah, but if Diet Coke's really any good, Rich, yeah, why is it that you only ever see really fat people drinking it?
Yeah. This week, you know, I realised it was time to do something about it, because it was partly what happened to me when I was minding my own business at home. Well, this is it.
Hello, Pizza Hut. May I take your order, please?
Hello there.
Richie!
Hey, Richie!
It's Richard Herring, our number one customer!
Thank you, because
of you, my 7 children and their families are still in work here.
Thank you, Mr. Herring. Hey, Mr. Herring, but hey, you didn't ring us up this lunchtime. We were worried about you. What happened?
Look, I just like to order...
Yeah, we know. 2 large Cadbury Fizz pizza, garlic bread supreme, Haagen-Dazs ice cream, and a bottle of Diet Pepsi for you and all your friends.
Jimmy Hill coming round. Jimmy Hill, Jimmy Hill.
And my address.
The man, you take the piece out of your old mates. We know your address by now.
Look, I'm going to have to go. There's someone at the door, right?
No, that's Miguel. We already sent him out. Saves us a lot of time. Yeah, saves a lot of time. It gets the oven free for our other customers.
Here's a little tip about dieting for you, Richard, what? And generally, is I've lost 1.5 stone in weight this year. I found a really good way of doing it, and it's this. It's make sure that your basic expenditure on travel, bills and rent far exceeds what you're earning, right? Yeah. And then have Mr. T.R. Johnson of Barclays Bank in Wandsworth demand the return of your Cashpoint card, despite the fact that you've given him contracts proving you'll be solvent by Christmas, so that you literally can't afford to buy any food to eat. Simple.
Fun.
Mr. Fun says don't bank with Mr. T.R. Johnson of Barclays in Wandsworth until they give Stuart Lee his Cashpoint card back.
Fist.
Stu, did you write that last jingle by any chance?
No, it was in the standard jingle pack we get from Radio 1.
Really?
Oh,
they cover for everything.
They've got one for every situation.
Now it's time for our first natural break. Now, if you can imagine a sort of short, chubby man, right, he's gone into a hall of mirrors at the end of a pier, and he's looking in a mirror that makes people appear very short and chubby, apart from a bit at the top, which makes his head sort of look really strange and elongated. Well, if you can get that image in your mind, you'll have a pretty good idea of what our next contributor looks like. He's a Welsh man, he comes from Balham, Peter Bainham. All right, Pete, how you doing?
Hello, Richard.
Yeah, have you been up to anything exciting this week in Balham? Right, great. So what have you been cooking up for us this week?
Oh, some more surprises, I hope.
Good.
Hello there, I'm Peter again, and I'm back with some more recipes made up by me and my brother Charlie, who's got a spot on his stomach at the moment and thinks it's cancer. I've also got some lifestyle ideas, such as what do you do if you have terrible trouble getting out of bed in the mornings? Just stay there. Time for my first recipe now. We all know what it's like to feel suddenly hungry after a half an hour sitting on the toilet, sobbing with your head in your hands, and you haven't got the energy to do anything fancy like toast or something like that. Well, here's my recipe for easy toast. All you need is a loaf of white sliced bread and a wardrobe. What you do is open the bread packet, which I did before, take out a piece of bread like that, then stand on a chair and put the piece of bread up on top of the wardrobe and leave it there for about 6 months. When you bring it down, it'll be all nice and hard like toast. And if your room's damp like mine, you should have a sort of topping on it that looks a bit like Stilton. Here's one I did earlier in March, and that's nice. That's lovely. Right, now last week I mentioned the petrol station, which is where you get food when the news agency is closed. Petrol stations are really good for shopping at night, but the main doors do shut after 1 a.m, so be careful never to order items which they can't get under the little glass sort of slot thing. Because Charlie made this mistake with a large carton of Just Juice, and now they won't serve him anymore. Right, now it's time for my main recipe tonight. This is for special occasions, like if you're feeling happy. It's called takeaway loaf, and it's a great way of using up all those bits of leftover takeaways, which are still lying around, I don't know, on the floor, on top of the toilet cistern, or still in your mouth at the back. Right, I'm going to make my takeaway loaf from the following. A bit of pie, which I found behind the radiator. An old sausage from Thursday. A hamburger, which I found on a wall, still hold that. Some chips and a bit of kebab, which I found stuck to Charlie's arm. Now, what you do is you take all the ingredients. Oh, there's a cigarette in there. I'll put that in there as well. And then just throw everything in and then just mash it up with your hands into a sort of loaf. If you can't remember what a loaf is shaped like, have a look at your loaf of white bread. Finally, put the loaf into a plastic bag like that. Nice bag I've got there. And hang it near to the heater just above the bathroom door. And leave it there for about an hour. And so we'll be trying that later on in the show. Bye.
Thought for the week. Simon Bates's 50-year broadcasting career ended last week. Batesy will be sorely missed by music biz insiders and his hundreds and thousands of listeners alike. In his dreams.
It's amazing, though, isn't it? It's just amazing that Batesy, old Master Batesy, as we call him on Radio 1, is finally gone. He was like an institution, wasn't he? Yeah. When I first heard that he was going, I tell you, I nearly jumped out of my skin, yeah. I tell you.
Well, I did jump out of my skin. Well, I say my skin, it was actually a suit made out of other people's skin. But I did the sewing, so technically speaking, it was mine.
Best of fun.
But Radio 1 is, of course, famous for its consciousness-raising campaigns, where celebrities from the world of pop music and TV and whatever come along and pretend to be concerned about the things that affect young people.
That's right, we've actually done this ourselves, haven't we, Stu? We wrote comedy sketches a couple of years ago about the dangers of drinking and smoking for two such Radio 1 campaigns. But ironically, we spent all the money we earned on booze and fags.
But it's okay, because Rich spent all the money from the anti-smoking one on booze, and I spent all the money from the anti-drinking one on fags, so we didn't compromise our artistic integrity in any way there.
But, you know, for our campaign, we want to pick something that directly affects you, our audience. And it seems, if the newspapers are to be believed, what affects students most is sex.
In The Sun this week, there was a horrible article about how students drink loads and they have promiscuous sex and then they have sort of topless go-go dancing things that was disgusting, really.
Nice! Things like that never happened when we were at university, did they, Stu?
Well, they did, Rich. It's just that no one ever invited you along.
So tell me, Lancaster University, is all this sex that The Sun says goes on in student places, is that true? Do you have a lot of sex here? Seems like he's getting it all over there, that man there. On his own, I would guess, but... I want to find out. I'll do my little bit of investigative reporting here. Yeah, you were a bit mouthy earlier on. Do you have a lot of sex?
No, not really.
No.
It's all lies.
Is it? All lies. So, well, what do you do to pass your time here at Lancaster University? There must be a myriad of other things to do out here in the countryside. That's pretty good.
If I could come in on this, yep. One of the things they do at Lancaster University is they have the opportunity to go out coppicing.
Yeah.
There's the Coppicing Society here.
Yeah.
That's COPPICING.
Yeah.
And they're having a bazaar later.
Sorry, I'm a bit, is that sex or not? I can't. Is that?
Don't really know what coppicing is. No.
That's the conservation volunteers. Anyone from the conservation volunteers in?
Yeah. There's an opportunity for hedge laying as well there. If anyone wants to get on.
Yes, for now. You're in the Conservation Society, I understand.
No, I'm not, but my friend is. But she does fences and dry stone walling.
Is this some kind of new drug speak? I don't understand. She does fencing, man.
Yeah,
is
I
that,
know.
We didn't have
well,
that, did we?
They have a lot of mushrooms, don't they? Have?
And anyone from the Dungeons & Dragons Society in? You are from the Dungeons & Dragons. And do you have a lot of sex in Dungeons & Dragons Society? I was wondering.
No, not really, no.
Do you have sort of elfin sex on a sort of mystical... mystical plane, imagined.
Dwarves are better, definitely.
Dwarves are the better ones. Yeah. I've found that in the real world as well. But Stuart knows the downside of promiscuous sex is unpleasant and unsightly rashes and diseases, don't you, Stuart?
Yeah, it is.
You
yeah,
found out this week, I think.
Thanks for pointing that out again, Rich. I did once contract a minor genital infection, yeah. But at least I've had the opportunity of doing so at some point in my life. Unlike you, Rich, who hasn't.
Yeah, very clever. Don't you even know it's a scientific fact, Stu, that some sexually transmitted diseases can be passed on from animals to humans? I haven't had the opportunity of that either, obviously, but it's just...
Anyway, the important thing to remember is there's nothing funny or embarrassing about having a sexually transmitted disease.
No, I think you'll find it is both funny and embarrassing, actually.
We've all heard, haven't we, campaigns warning you how not to catch a sexually transmitted disease, but no one ever tells you what to do once you've actually got one, do they? I mean, I went in the clinic, right, with a minor case of genital warts there, and the... bloke in there said, oh, these are really hard to get rid of. They're not very dangerous, but they are hard to shift. You'd have been better off getting something worse that can be treated with antibiotics like gonorrhea or VD. I said to him, I wasn't aware there was a choice. But I will know for next time, so that's good. So, in the light of experience, here is my Fist of Fun STD advice.
Fist of Fun, sexually transmitted disease advice.
Hello, I'm your local GP. Now, if you think you have a sexually transmitted disease, I'll be the first person you come to. I will take one look at your horrible, pussy, scabby genitals and I'll say, oh my God, what's that? Now, that is disgusting. Get your hideous diseased body out of my nice, clean office now. Do you expect some kind of prize, dear, for coming in a responsible, courageous, mature way and seeking advice on a problem that could threaten yours and other people's lives? Well, dream on, leper. Do you realise? God, watch out, all my normal patients. He is unclean. Cover your face, Mr. Jarvis. Don't breathe in the germs.
Fist of Fun. 1FM cares about your genitals.
Once you arrive at the genitourinary infections clinic, you'll meet me. I'm the sexually transmitted disease doctor. When I was at medical school, I didn't really work very hard. I prefer to spend my time running around pissed dressed up as an ostrich. For charity. Luckily, there wasn't much competition for the job of looking at an endless parade of diseased genitals, so they let me have it. I'm sorry, I don't really know what I'm doing at all. But don't worry, you just stand there with your pants down while I prod at your most sensitive and precious parts with this scalpel that... They gave me. Remember, you can't tell just by looking at someone if they've had a sexually transmitted disease. Although, if there's large weeping sores all over their genitals and anus, that is usually a good clue, I think.
Fist of Fun, looking rather too closely at the things in your pants.
Hello, I'm the genitourinary infections clinic treatment nurse. I like to think that cheeky humour and innuendo will relax patients whose genitals are about to come into contact with a burning hot beam of laser-style energy. Only kidding. Now, hang on to your hat, young fellow. This'll make your toes curl. May the force be with you, eh?
I'm on fire!
Yes, you are, literally. Look at you. Not so much a strange lump on your penis as a strange penis on your lump, eh?
Fist of Fun, rubbing salt into your open wound.
Hi there, I'm your sexually transmitted disease counsellor. Notice I make a point of shaking you by the hand so you won't feel that you're an untouchable. But don't get any funny ideas, all right? Because that is as far as it goes with someone in your condition. Don't worry, I do understand you're suffering a loss of self-esteem, partly because of the moral sexual guilt created by 2,000 years of Judeo-Christian culture, but largely because you realise you aren't going to get a shag for ages. Don't be embarrassed, please. Just sit down. On the newspaper, if you don't mind.
Fist of Fun, washing its hands of your problem.
But Fist of Fun listeners, don't worry, it isn't all bad news, right? One of your moral obligations as a victim of a minor sexually transmitted disease is to inform all your previous lovers. So you can ring them up and you go, hello, it's me. Yes, remember, the trusting, innocent man whose heart you smashed into the dirt. Yeah. Well, you know, when we were going out, you used to complain that I never gave you anything. Well...
It was fun.
Fist of Fun. Fist of Fun.
All of us have got people we know once a part of our lives, but have since sort of vanished and disappeared. Mm. And we thought, seeing as we're on Radio 1, we'd take advantage of the mass media sort of thing that we've got at our disposal and try and track a few of them down.
Yeah.
For example, I'd like to know where my mum and dad are. anyone?
But Stu, I actually have already found one person from my life. Yeah, I always wanted to know what happened to the girl at my school who smelt of spam. She sat in the back in spelling, I don't remember. She lived above the laundrette with her mum and had yellowy, gingery, sort of black-red hair. I don't know if you remember. Well, I've tracked her down, specially for Fist of Fun, and here she is, the girl from my school who smelt of spam. Hello, that girl who smelt of spam.
Hello, Rich. It's very nice of you to invite me on the show after all this time.
Look, I'm Stu. I'm really sorry. I didn't know this was happening. And, you know, he's... I think
hello.
He's
just... Stu! Hi. Nice to meet
Stu.
You.
You shook hands with the girl that smells of spam. You touched her.
Rich, shut up. Come on, she's your guest on here now.
If I could just interrupt, actually, Rich. I never did really smell of spam.
You did? Oh, smell-oo.
No, I didn't.
spam pants.
I didn't, Richard. I didn't smell of spam. Did you ever actually smell me?
No. If you went near you, you got fleas. I wouldn't even touch you.
No, look, Rich, I didn't actually have fleas. I think you'll find that the flea is a member of the Siphoneptera species of insect, and it's parasitic chiefly on rodents in the mammalian class, and most larger animals that suckle their young are largely free of flea infestation.
Well, you still smell of spam.
I did not. Look, it was just that because I had glasses and slightly unusually coloured hair, and my mother...
Who looked like a man.
Yes. Who did actually happen to look like a man and couldn't afford to buy me a proper school uniform. That was why you all picked on me. Now, that's not really something very clever, is it, to just mock someone?
Spam!
Give her a chance, right? And anyway, surely the point of having the girl who spelt of spam on the whatever became of spot is to find out what she's up to now, right? Not to cruelly taunt her in exactly the same way she did 20 years ago.
Well, I suppose so. So anyway, what are you doing these days then, the girl that smelt of spam? Apart from smelling of spam, of course.
Well, due to all the taunts and cruelty I suffered as a child, Richard, I came to believe that I really was worthless. Through my teens, I looked for comfort in a string of meaningless sexual encounters. I'd just commit any degrading act just for the few seconds of attention it would bring. And in the end, I had a child, Amy, who I loved very much, and she loved me, but the authorities declared me an unfit parent, and she was taken away from me, and I don't know where she...
That's enough. Really, thanks for going through that. If you want to just go out, there's someone
thanks.
At the back will take care of
thanks,
you.
Thanks, Stuart. You've been very kind.
Taxi or something away, they'll sort it out. Well, Rich, well done, mate. I hope you're pleased with yourself making that girl's life turn out like that.
Yeah, it's bad, isn't it?
Yeah, it is bad.
The taunting doesn't seem so funny anymore now I'm 26. Yeah. It's just sort of childish, isn't it? I hope any 5 or 6-year-olds listening to the show will learn the important moral of this piece. And now treat all their classmates as equals, whatever their background, appearance or...
Well done, Rich. It's really good that you've said that. And, you know, now yeah. I'd like to move
Stu,
on... Yeah?
Are you speaking into that microphone there?
Yes, Rich.
That's the microphone the girl who smelt of spam used. Ah! You've got the stinking spam disease. Spam
when will you ever grow up, yeah. mate?
Well, I suppose smelling of spam's the least of your worries, isn't it, hey, Al?
Fist of Fun, continuing the ritual humiliation of those who are different well into adult life.
Fist.
Anyway, I've been thinking, Stu, about religion, those letters we got at the beginning. You know, how can we be sure that Mrs. Clegg and that bloke from Southampton aren't right after all? I mean, maybe Jesus is real. Do you think, Stu?
Well, I don't think that Jesus exists as such, Rich. No. Well, what I think is that around the time of the Jews, yeah. there was probably an ordinary man who did a lot of charitable work, like Bob Geldof or someone. But people then were very suspicious, weren't they? So they couldn't understand
right.
what he was doing. So they thought he was a god, and they said, you know, you're Jesus, you know, they called him Jesus. Do you see what I mean?
That's an interesting and highly original theory, Stu.
Yeah,
I've never heard anything like that before. But the thing is, Stu, my old headmaster at Fairlands Middle School, Mr. Broom, he told me that Jesus was literally real, right?
Oh,
he's everywhere, all the time, watching us. He's in my house, he's in your house.
Is he in Marks and Sparks, is he?
Yeah.
What, an hour before it opens?
Yeah,
morning,
he is, yeah.
Is he in Peter Bainham's flat having a nice loaf,
yeah,
takeaway loaf?
Is he
in the Lancaster University Dungeons & Dragons Society meeting? Is he down there?
Yeah, he's on his own there, obviously. Yeah.
Really gets on my nerves the way that as kids we get indoctrinated into these religious ideas. Like, as we go into the 21st century, we have to abandon religion, right?
Stu,
what?
Look,
what
it's
is
Jesus,
it?
Jesus, he's here, literally in the theatre. It's Jesus, he's behind
Rich,
you.
Rich, I've said.
He's behind
said,
you. Tell him, everyone. He's behind you.
Don't encourage him,
but
right?
He is there, isn't he? Yes.
Look, there's no such thing as a literal God.
Look, he's blessing the little lambs on the man. The children, they're
yeah, yeah. All right.
Him.
All right. Okay. All right, Rich. If Jesus is real, right?
If he is.
If I turn round, I'll see him, won't I? Right.
Yes.
Okay. Right. I'm gonna turn round and I'm gonna look for Jesus now.
Oh.
He's not. He wasn't there at all.
He wasn't.
Look. If you look at a situation like Northern Ireland, right, a lot of the problems there are caused by religious sectarianism. There's two things we could do. Sort it out, or just jack the whole thing in, basically.
Jesus is back again. Look, he's carrying his cross to Calvary. Look at his baleful yet
Rich,
holy eyes.
Look, I'm trying to introduce the free-thinking ideals of W.G. Foote here to the Radio 1 audience,
tell
right?
Tell him, everyone! He's
behind you!
What did you say? I'm sorry.
He's behind you!
You're have to shout louder. I'm very old. All right, okay, all right.
Stewie's nailing himself up on the cross now, Stu. He's miming his passion. It's to behold. His tears are falling to the floor.
All right, okay, look. All right, just to keep you happy. I'll turn round. And if Jesus is real, I'll see him, all right? Yeah. I'm going to turn round and I'm going to look now. I didn't see anything.
You must have seen it.
Where?
You must have seen it. Jesus fell over. You must have
what? I've done here, is he? Where? I can't see him at all. There's nothing there, mate. Nothing there at all on that one.
He was there, wasn't he, everyone?
Yes! Look, for the last time, okay? Right, I'm not going to go over it again. The offices of the Freethinker Society. The Freethinker Society offices.
He's flicking the bees in your head, showing you his bum and everything.
Yes, I'm sure he is, isn't he, Rich?
He is.
Look, I've explained before, as I said,
Jesus! You are real!
Oh, Jesus! Holy, holy, holy!
No, I'm not the real Jesus. Sorry, I'm just one of his helpers. Sorry.
His helpers.
I mean, you know, obviously it's hard for Jesus to be omnipresent, you know, all the time, you know. I mean, especially during the busy times of the holy calendar, like, you know, Christmas, Easter.
Michaelmas?
Not so much Michaelmas, right. Now you come to mention it, actually. But anyway, he has helpers, right? So, you know, if you ever see two Jesuses in a toy shop grotto or a Christmas parade, remember Jesus is real, and that's just one of his helpers helping him through the busy period, basically.
No. Mate, I think what you've done, right, is you've confused Jesus of Nazareth with Father Christmas, haven't you?
Oh, yes, I have, yes. Now, that would explain why I haven't been getting much work.
This is just an old sheet.
That's a terrible beard, that is. It comes off. Do we pay you for this, or do we have to send it to the real Jesus directly, the money for this?
Well, strictly speaking, right, it should go to Jesus, but you know he likes to take 15% off the top, so you give it to me backstage, no questions asked.
Won't you be in trouble if Jesus finds out what you've been up to?
Yeah, well, how's he going to? I mean, you know, can't be everywhere at once, can he? I mean, just one more thing. What? Keep it under your hats, lads, you know, we don't want to spoil the magical illusion for the little ones, you know, little kiddie winkies, do we?
It's you.
Yeah, you had me there
with
that.
Beans,
yes.
Absolutely marvellous fun.
This of fun.
Right, Stu, I think that's the end of the show, isn't it, now?
Yeah, I think so,
at last. Yeah. Right, it's time once again, as always, to get into our big comedy double-act partner's bed, isn't
God,
it?
Not again. We have to do this every week.
Yeah, of course we do, yeah, and we get everyone in with us. Rebecca, come on into bed with us, Rebecca. Right. How are you doing? All right, well done. Yeah. Rebecca, now, you're probably best known as the woman who played a trick on Eddie Large on Noel's house party, aren't you?
Now, I think I'm probably best known for my comedy characters on the award-winning radio show On the Hour, really.
No, I don't think so. You're doing yourself down there. The trick on Eddie Large was brilliant. Did you see his face when he found out what Sid and you have been doing? It was brilliant.
Yeah.
So it was a bit like that face, you know, he pulls at the end of every sketch he's ever done ever.
Yeah.
Only better, you
know.
He's
a very funny and gifted man.
Also joining us on the show, I'm really pleased to welcome into the bed Kevin Eldon. Now, Kev, you're probably best known, aren't you, for... being on this show last week, aren't you?
My mum, her name's Reen, by the way. Yeah. She said son of the woman she's a dinner lady with thought it's quite good.
Great. Thanks so much. Right, well, pull back the continental style duvet for Peter Bainham. Come on, Pete, and bring your curry with you.
Your bits have been going down very well, haven't they, over the weeks, Pete?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you'd better pull back a bit unless you want to find out what Fist of Fun really means.
Fist of Fun was recorded on the Radio 1-4 Comedy Tour as part of the National Comedy Network. Right, time to get to sleep, everyone.
Stuart's not still infectious, is he?
You can put on some protective clothing.
Yeah, I'll sign it then.
Okay.
Fist of Fun.